On this episode of Masters of the Air Talks, John and I are comparing our top five World War II movies. Each of us selected our own criteria, so we'll be sharing why we chose the movies that we did and share a little clip from each one. And just to let you know, as you're watching, if you'd like to share your top five movies in the comments, please be sure to do that. We would love to hear it. So John, let's start with you. What are the reasons, or let's begin with what is the criteria that you used for selecting your top five movies?
Well, good morning. Thanks for having me on. In my criteria, I wanted to stay with just military action type movies, ones that dealt with combat missions. I left out, not on purpose, but I just left out the historical fiction, which is like Inglourious Bastards and Jojo Rabbit and Schindler's List. Well, actually, on historical fiction, just Jojo Rabbit. But I also left out movies that were more Holocaust, like Schindler's List, what I was going to say, and The Boy in the Striped Pajamas. So my top five are just pretty much
stayed with these. In other words, they're great movies, yes. And you don't want anybody dogging you for not putting them on your list. That is why. But here's
and
your
also
list.
You know, the historical ones like Casablanca,
right?
And you know, World War II movie and all that. So I stay with military action only. My number five is Bridge Over the River Kwai, released in 1957, directed by David Lane. And the main reason I picked this movie was two reasons. One, it shows the POW scenes, and then Masters of the Air in the book in the miniseries, we're going to be going into POW situations. Bridge Over River Kwai is just so iconic with the theme song, the men marching into the POW, and the whole movie shows how important it is for men to have discipline and morale during these horrific conditions. And as you'll see, this scene coming in the clip.
So my list is based on, one, movies that affected me. Anything that really moved me and I felt was meaningful made my list. So I didn't limit myself to whether it was fictional or not. And the other criteria is just movies that I've seen over and over again. Well, my number five is Inglourious Basterds from 2009, directed by Quentin Tarantino. Tarantino's films are absolutely revolutionary. And when I first saw that movie, I had never seen anything like it. It was shocking in a great way. The opening scene starts with a lot of realism and suspense that you typically get with a World War II movie dealing with the Holocaust, showing the fear of the Jews that were hidden and all the Nazis nearby. But then it moves into a fantasy, just this pure fantasy that is, for me, I would use the phrase, it's soul satisfying, because at the end, spoiler alert, you're going to watch a theater burn down with all the right people trapped inside. And it just makes you want to stand up and cheer. And although it's entirely fiction, Tarantino's genius actually takes you through history. And to me, it's both a war movie and it pays homage to war movies. It's a comedy and it's a drama. Christoph Waltz is absolutely one of my favorite actors. And in this movie, he is outstanding. I learned some of the history of the movie, and Tarantino, that character was so important, and he had to be able to move through the different languages, English, French, German, even a little bit of Italian, and just have this persona and he was having a hard time finding the right actor. And as soon, and Christopher Waltz actually auditioned when he was just about ready to give up, which I, you know, it's miracle, a movie miracle that he was found, because he just, he is so amazing. He makes you fall in love, or I guess not fall in love is the wrong word. He makes you admire a villain. I mean, he just steals every scene. I enjoyed watching him so much, even though you're just like, want to beat him up also. And, but with all of the artistic perfection of this film, cause I could go on. What I also love most about this movie is just how ingeniously witty the lines are. And, most of them delivered by Brad Pitt. So I feel he's as important as Christoph Waltz in this movie. And, so my scene that I selected is actually, just a compilation of the top 10 quotes from Inglourious Basterds.
But weren't you heard of us, you probably heard we ain't in the prisoner taking business. We in the killing Nazi business. And cousin, businesses are booming.
Sind wir aufgestiegen in der Welt? Das schon, Herr Obersturmführer. Mit Ihrer Geschichte an Insubordination. Wahrlich bemerkenswert.
Just keep your fucking mouth shut. In fact, why don't you start practicing right now?
J'essayais simplement d'être amical.
Je ne souhaite pas être votre ami.
You know, Lieutenant, you're pretty good at that. Why you get to Carnegie Hall, don't you? Practice.
You know, fighting in a basement offers a lot of difficulties. Number one being, you're fighting in a basement.
Yeah, they made that deal, but they don't give a fuck about him. They need you.
You'll be shot for this?
Nah, I don't think so. More like chewed out. I've been chewed out before.
Ooh, that's a bingo.
Is that the way you say it? That's a bingo?
You just say bingo.
Bingo! How fun!
But I digress. Where were we?
See how feeders into your Nazi boss.
Signori, questo è un vecchio amico mio, Colonnello Hans Landa della SS.
Buongiorno.
My number four is probably one of the movies that doesn't make a lot of top five World War II movies. It's the only one that I have really ever watched that shows from a Russian, the Western Front perspective. And it's my number four is Enemy at the Gates, released in 2001. Directed by Jean Anand, and I know I probably butchered that name, but I did the best I could. And it shows the Battle of Stalingrad. And one of the reasons I picked this movie, because when we watched the first two episodes of Masters of the Air, you know, we're seeing these almost suicidal missions that these men are thrown into, and the horrific death rates from these missions. And Enemy at the Gates shows what was happening on the Russian front. And the very first scene in this movie just shows basically suicide missions. They had more men than they did guns. And as you're going to see in this clip, they hand a gun to every other person, and then they hand a clip of four bullets to the second person. And they're telling them, when the first person dies, pick up his gun and put your bullets in it and keep running until you die. So, you know, and what you see this on the screen, and you just feel for these men. They're drafted, they're put on train cars, and then they're unloaded and they're handed a gun and told to run straight into the German fronts. So here's our clip of Enemy at the Gates.
Sauber draufhalten!
Thank you.
My number four is Life is Beautiful, a 1997 film directed, co-written, and starring Roberto Benigni. It is a romantic comedy drama about the relationship between a fun-loving father and his young son. Now, normally you wouldn't put the words comedy and romantic in a backdrop set during the Holocaust. And that's what's so unique about this film. Life is Beautiful and Inglourious Basterds are both fictional war movies. And yet they made my list. Truth be told, Inglourious Basterds probably could make my top five all-time movie list because of how many times I've watched it. And Life is Beautiful could potentially make, close to number one on my all-time favorite. And the reason is because it is just astounding to be able to watch a movie where you laugh and you feel hopeful and your heart is warmed over and over and over again, all set against the backdrop of World War II and the Holocaust. And even has a somewhat tragic ending, which I won't talk about, but yet your heart is high, your spirits are lifted. And that's because the way that the film is written, it's this man, Guido, who falls in love with a woman, and the first half of it is just their courtship, and it's just precious, and it's funny, and they have a son, and then war comes, and the father and son are taken to a concentration camp, and the mother insists on being taken as well, because she wants to be where they are, even though she didn't have to go. And then once they arrive in the camp, the father is all about protecting his son from the evils and the horror around him. And he does this by telling his son that this is all just a game that they're playing, and that there's ways that they can score points. And if they win the game, they get a real live tank. And his son believes it, and he's just young enough to believe it. And so, but for me, the film radiates hope and belief that despite the cruelty and atrocities that this world can contain, life is still beautiful. And it doesn't downplay the Holocaust at all. And it doesn't even stray away from the horrors of it. Like I said, the ending is gut-punching, but yet you still come away with this great hope that mankind has the ability to control his world through perspective, kindness, humor, and especially finding hope. So with that said, the scene that I selected is great. It's where you see the father kind of finding an opportunity to share with his son what are the rules of this game.
Achtung! Gut! Gibt es hier einen Italiener, der Deutsch spricht?
Che ha detto? Cerca uno che parla tedesco. Spiega tutte le regole del campo. Che sei tedesco? No.
Alles hören, ich sage das nur einmal.
Comincia il gioco. Chi c'è c'è, chi non c'è non c'è.
Ihr seid nur aus einem einzigen Grund in dieses Lager transportiert worden?
Si vince a 1000 punti. Il primo classificato vince un carro armato, vero?
Um zu arbeiten.
Beato lui.
Jeder Versuch der Sabotage wird mit dem sofortigen Tode bestraft. Die Hinrichtungen finden auf dem Hof durch Schüsse in den Rücken statt.
Ogni giorno vi daremo la classifica generale da quell'altoparlante là. All'ultimo classificato verrà attaccato con un cartello con su scritto asino qui sulla schiena.
Ihr habt die Ehre, für unser großes deutsches Vaterland arbeiten zu dürfen und am Bau des Großdeutschen Reiches teilzunehmen.
Noi facciamo la parte di quelli cattivi, cattivi che urlano. Chi ha paura perde punti.
Drei Grundregeln solltet ihr nie vergessen. Erstens, versuche nicht zu fliehen. Zweitens, folge jedem Befehl ohne Fragen. Drittens, jeder Versuch eines Aufstandes wird mit dem Tod durch Erhängen bestraft. Ist das klar?
In tre casi si perdono tutti i punti. Li perdono. Uno, quelli che si mettono a piangere. Due, quelli che vogliono vedere la mamma. Tre, quelli che hanno fame e vogliono la merendina. Scordatevela!
Ihr solltet glücklich sein, hier arbeiten zu dürfen. Es wird niemandem etwas geschehen, der die Vorschriften befolgt.
È molto facile perdere punti per la fame. Io stesso ieri ho perso 40 punti perché volevo a tutti i costi un panino con la marmellata.
Gehorsamkeit ist alles.
Dal Bigorche.
Und noch etwas.
Lui di Fragole.
Bei diesem Pfiff Alles raus auf den Hof, aber schnell!
Ah, non chiedete i lecca lecca, perché non ve li danno, ce li mangiamo tutti noi!
Antreten in zweier Reihe!
Io ieri non ho mangiato i venti!
Schweigt!
Mal di pancia!
Jeden Morgen!
Però erano buoni!
Is appell!
Lascia fare!
So, das wollte ich euch noch sagen. Dort hinten werdet ihr arbeiten. Ihr werdet die Dimensionen des Lagers leicht begreifen.
Scusate se vado di fretta, ma oggi sto giocando a nascondino. Ora vado, se no mi fanno tana.
My number three is The Thin Red Line, released in 1998, directed by Terrence Malick. Excuse my pronunciation. I hope I got that right. the main reason I picked this movie, it's one of my all-time favorites, but it's not a movie that you watch over and over. I mean, it's pretty dark. And when you watch it, you realize kind of the difference between fighting the men that were fighting in the Pacific versus the European theater in World War II. World War II in Europe was a lot more of a distant fighting. You were shooting at men across fields. You were dropping bombs and stuff. But so much of the fighting in the Pacific was hand-to-hand and up close and personal. And The Thin Red Line just does a wonderful job of showing how they were just kind of fighting hand-to-hand, going from, you know, one little hole that the Japanese, the tunnels, it shows just all the hand-to-hand fighting that was so personal. And it's very, very, very dark. And this clip shows a little bit of how intense the fighting was and how up close and personal it was. It's a wonderful movie. I hope you get to watch it. It's not on a lot of top five lists, but that's the reason why I picked it. So here's our clip.
My number three selection is The Longest Day, a 1962 film with three directors, Ken Annakin, Andrew Martin, and Bernard Wicki. It is an absolute classic war movie. It is The Longest Day. It's also the longest movie, practically, at 3 hours, but it tells the events of D-Day from all different perspectives. It was taken from a book, adapted from a book by Cornelius Ryan titled The Longest Day, The Classic Epic of D-Day. And I love it because it follows dozens of characters in the U.S., Germany, British, and French sides. So you've just seen it from all different sides. And while Saving Private Ryan has probably one of the best action scenes of the landings, this one, this old timer, still remains... It's at the height for its scope and its retelling of the story of the Normandy invasion. There's just so much more going on. It had a stellar cast at the time, pretty much the A-list who's who of men and some women. And it was a joint effort, like I said, of three directors, and it had about five writers. So there was just so much put into this film. It was the definitive treatment of D-Day, and, it really brings a lot more to that event than any other film. And I just wanted, before I show the clip that I chose, I wanted to share that the son of a member of the 101st Airborne said that his dad watched The Longest Day and he said it got his seal of approval. So to me, whenever you hear a veteran that was part of that experience approve something, that says a lot. And I just want to read a quote. It says, this son said, yes, this movie is long and it has lots of people and sometimes it's confusing. Dad said that it was accurate on all of these points. There was constant tension and it wasn't clear who was winning. Were the people behind the next hedgerow friends or enemies or frightened civilians? The movie goes easy on much of the brutality. In real life, there was a lot of blood and wounds that you just don't want to see, but the movie may be as good as it gets for a battle movie. So I just thought that was interesting that sometimes this movie gets criticized for being a little bit too disconnected and hodgepodgey, but for a veteran to say, you know, that's kind of how it was. You just didn't know. Is that an enemy or is it a friend? So anyway, with that being said, the scene I selected is a landing. We got a landing at the start of Private Ryan. And this is the landing at Point du Hoc, where the Rangers had to go and take out a nest of cannons, I believe it was, that were set up there in order to protect all of the other beaches.
My number two is actually companion movies. Letters of Iwo Jima and the Flags of Our Father, released in 2006, directed by the world famous Clint Eastwood. One thing I admired about this, when I say companion movies, if you've not watched them, you need to watch them. They're from the Japanese perspective in Letters from Iwo Jima, and then Flags of Our Father is from the American perspective of the same battle. And the genius to do this, and I got to give kudos to the studios and for Clint Eastwood to even attempt to do something like this, just really amazed me. And to show the exact same battle from two different perspectives, you really feel for the men in these situations. The clip I chose, one from Letters from Iwo Jima, shows the suicide scene. And you just feel for these men that they're so ultra patriotic, and their culture is to be suicidal before you surrender. And see, for Americans, that's just so hard for us to imagine. And the scene, you can tell some of these men don't want to do it, but they fall for peer pressure and they fall for what's expected of them. And it's, to me, very, very dramatic and everything. And then, of course, Flags of Our Father shows the most iconic scene from the most iconic picture of World War II when they're raising the flag with the Marines, Life magazine. And I kind of thought it was a little bit humorous that the movie actually shows how accidental that picture was. They didn't even know if they captured it. And at the time, they really didn't even think it was a big deal. And the whole movie, it's the first time I saw a World War II movie that Flags of Our Father that showed the PTSD of these men. And they're getting patted on their back and they're getting paraded around, and it shows their alcohol problems. It shows the problems that were never addressed. And it's just a wonderful, wonderful movie. So let's go to the clips and share it together.
Banzai! 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 favor, you put this up, will you?
Yes, sir. All right, spine a pole.
Take the flag down, boys. Captain's order. Go. You heard him, let's do it.
All right, hang on. So, what a hell of a view.
A view from up here, yes, I'd say somewhere safe. Here she goes.
Ready? Go.
You get it?
I don't know. Wish I could have seen her faces.
My choice for number two is Hacksaw Ridge, a 2016 movie directed by Mel Gibson. My publishing company is Triumph Press. And I have another channel on YouTube called Triumph Talks. So if you get to know anything about me, you'll find out that I love Triumph. And this movie is a Triumph story. And so that's the reason it made it so high on my list. It represents the choosing to sacrifice to protect others in the face of danger. It's a true story. So my true story here is on a World War II private first class Desmond T. Doss, who was the first conscientious objector to receive the Congressional Medal of Honor. Now, maybe his conscientious objector in that he didn't want to go and fight, but that didn't prevent him from volunteering to go to help. And so he signed up and became a medic. Basic training kind of shows the adversity he faced right away, because he didn't shirk any duty except for rifle practice, because he had no intention of carrying a weapon or shooting or killing anyone. And that decision angers the people around him, and they just look at it as cowardice. But he gets his respect later when he gets to this battle called Hacksaw Ridge that is just bloody and gruesome. And honestly, a lot of, you know, we keep referring to Saving Private Ryan's opening, the landing, and how just unbelievable that scene is. Hacksaw Ridge is no less bloody. It might even be more in some ways. It's just an intense scene. And so it really shows, I think, his bravery, that he was there not carrying a weapon. The scene that I chose is really significant. And I'm actually not going to talk about the scene ahead of it too much. I just want you to watch it, and then I'm going to point out some of the things that I feel make this such an important scene, not just for this movie, but I feel is an important scene for all of us. There's just some really significant messages that come, and it's so beautifully filmed, and yet it's in the midst of this horrific moment in this battle. So with that, let's just go ahead and watch the scene, and then I'll share a little bit why I chose this clip.
We gotta get out of here!
Yeah.
understand? I can't hear you.
So to me, the most powerful moment in this movie is when Desmond has just lost his dearest friend, Smitty. And you see him at the start of this clip, just kind of closing his eyes, and he's sitting there, and he's, I feel this is an important scene for all of us because I think we can all relate to his feelings. Suddenly he's confused. He's lost someone he loves. He's in this horrible situation, and he stops and he says, I don't understand. I don't know what to do. And I know in my life, I've had times when things have happened. I had a daughter die of SIDS at 7 months old. And my only sister died 2 years ago unexpectedly right before Christmas. And you hit these moments and it's just a gut punch so hard. And that's where he was at. And so he's sitting there and you just see tears come to his eyes. And he's questioning God. I don't hear you. I don't know what to do. And then the answer comes in the form of the cries of the men who are screaming for a medic. Sorry. And it's inside, it's towards the battle. At the start of the scene, everybody's dropping off the ridge. They're running, they're getting away. And he hears the cries of these men and he stands up. And he doesn't, I love how this was filmed because he doesn't make a big speech or he doesn't say, you know, off to work. He just says, very humbly, he says, all right. Like you see, you witness him hear his answer and he puts on his helmet and he runs into the explosions. And I'm just getting chills as I talk about it. So I know maybe I should have shared that ahead of it, but I just kind of wanted you to have a chance to see it without me affecting what you're seeing. And hopefully you saw that in that clip.
Great movie.
So before we move into our number ones, we're just going to take a moment and each of us are going to share our honorable mentions. So maybe, John, this will give you a chance to redeem yourself in case anybody out there is going, how could you forget this or that? You know, and I'll redeem myself, hopefully, too, with my honorable mention choices. So go ahead and carefully list which ones you've chosen.
Well, my honorable mentions at number five is Das Boot, which is the German perspective on the U-boats. My number four is probably, you know, one of the most famous is Patton. I grew up with that movie. Number three honorable mention is probably just a personal favorite of mine, and it's Memphis Belle, probably the most Hollywood movie of all of them I have on the list. Number two, yes. Number two is Dunkirk. Just a wonderful, it's so accurate in its depiction of a battle. And my number one, we shared together. And this, I almost put this in my top five, was Hacksaw Ridge, as you just explained. Wonderful movie.
Thank you.
Yes.
All right. You've regained my respect. For putting Hacksaw, yep. No, not regained. I love the movies you've selected, honestly. Yeah. I love that we actually had different criteria because I think it allowed us to kind of explore beyond the same selection by doing
absolutely.
That.
So, and we had more, you know, like nine different movies to talk about.
And we didn't even talk about it ahead of time. We both just made our criteria and ran with it. So it's kind of worked out well. So my honorable mentions include Come and See, very difficult movie to watch about the suffering in the Holocaust, but extremely important. So I had to put it on there. Unbroken, it's another triumph film. So I had to have a triumph. Schindler's List, Dunkirk, and Das Boot. So we definitely have some crossover there. All right. Well, with that, John, would you like to announce your number one pick of World War
II? People might have heard this. It might not be a big surprise. Of course, my number one, I think it's our number one, is Saving Private Ryan.
We both picked Saving Private Ryan. Yeah. And that's 1998 by Steven Spielberg.
What was your favorite part of the movie? And we both talked about the first scene, which is so iconic. Is there another part you want to talk about?
Oh, gosh. It's the opening sequence, of course, is hard hitting, and it was shocking. And I don't know that I had ever seen, of course, this preceded Hacksaw Ridge. I talk about Hacksaw Ridge being really bloody and shocking, but it preceded that. I think that's so memorable. But then kind of going beyond that, I guess we should cite it's a fictional movie. Yes. You actually did have a fiction on your list. But it's fictional, and yet I think it reveals so many things that are important about that war, about the feelings that people had. It was definitely a propaganda mission that these men were on to rescue Ryan, Private Ryan, just because his mother had lost so many, and there's just some other things that they kind of wanted to use this to keep the morale at home. And there's this interesting band of men that were put together to set out on this mission, led by Tom Hanks's character. And I think it's so funny. They knew this could be a suicide mission. They were not excited about expending their skills on just rescuing somebody. They wanted to go fight Hitler, and they called it FUBAR, which, it's a kind of a very iconic military term. And so that's some of the things that drew me to it. What did you think of it?
I think it had, for me personally, one of the best endings of all the World War II movies, at the cemetery. And this is a little bit personal for me, because I know my granddad, and in the movie, he's looking and he looks at his wife talking about, have I lived a good life? And so many of these World War II veterans, they felt a little guilt for surviving. And they really did question, have I earned the right to live? So that was very personal. My granddad fought with that most of his life. And then also I think it drove a lot of the Greatest Generation to accomplish so much in their life, because they did feel that way. They felt that they owed their comrades that had, died, beside them, in front of them, with them, that they owed it to them to live a good life. So that's a little bit of my personal reason at the end of them.
That's a powerful, that's such a powerful takeaway from that and many of the movies, like you said. I think that, I believe this is true. And I hope that as we are all watching these movies and reliving in a way these experiences, that we're coming to appreciate the sacrifices that have been made for us and our freedom, and truly ask ourselves, am I living worthy of those sacrifices? And I hope that's something people take from that. So with that said, we'll go ahead and set up the scene that we selected from this, which is just the opening scene where they're on the boat and nervous, not knowing what to expect. And as soon as that gate drops, they find out pretty quick what to expect.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for joining us and learning about what our top five movies are from the World War II era. We want to know what yours are, so be sure to share yours in the comments. And feel free to congratulate us or dog us if we made good choices or bad choices. We want to hear about that too. This is really an opportunity that we're taking to set up a new concept here for our Masters of the Air Talks. Right now, we are conducting live shows at the end of every new episode of the Masters of the Air series that's being played on Apple TV. And when that ends, we'll be kicking off what we're going to be calling our Military Movie Club. So it's kind of like a book club, but every week we'll watch a different movie and then we'll all come together on Saturday mornings at the same time that we're meeting for our live shows, which is 10 Eastern. And I'll let you figure out what that means to you and what your time zone is. But at 10 a.m. Eastern every Saturday morning, we'll come together and have a live show where we talk about the movie that we just watched. We'd love to get your comments, but we would also love to have you right here in the studios talking about what you love or criticize or are impressed by the movie that is chosen. So in order to get the schedule, we'll put a schedule out every month of the four movies or five, if you know, depending on how the weeks run, what movies that we'll be watching that month. Go to mastersoftheairtalks.com and sign up to get on our email list. And we promise not to bombard you other than just to share with you the schedule for the movies to watch for that month. You can also communicate with us there. And so if there's a movie that you would like to see us watch as a club, you can submit that. And we are 100% going to be watching for and using your suggestions for that as well. So be sure to subscribe to this channel and you will get notifications when our live shows are about to air and anytime we have a new episode up. And we sure enjoy having you be a part of our community.